started. If y'all want to stay in and worship with us this morning, it's so good to be back. Hey, let's give a round of applause to be back in the Lord's house this morning. Amen. To be with the family and still have their time. So we're going to ask Donnie to come up now.
Can you hear me? Good. All right. So I like to talk with my hands, so you're going to have to deal with me moving this mic back and forth. So, kids, I want to ask you a question real quick, all right? How many of y'all want that little dollar bill? Anybody want that? Kids? No? Why not? It's a dollar bill. You can take it to the store and get nothing. Nothing. Right? Oh, got one. You know what? You can't have it. I'm going to let her have it. There you go. She can have it. That's fine. So it's not going to do me any good. If you take that thing to the store, you're not going to be able to buy anything. As a matter of fact, Mr. Massey will probably come and pick you up and show you a nice back of a car. All right? You can't use the fake money. But you want to know something? There are people out there that do try and make fake money. They can copy it. See, what you really want is that right there, right? Now, do I have some kids' attention? Okay, now, see, got some eyes moving with me, even some adults, good. All right, see, we see it's printed on the front and the back. You know what? I'm just going to have to give that one to you, too. Okay, there you go. We're paying our kids here. I have to do the same thing upstairs. So, anyway, with the same thing, we are able to print that money off. They can try and print it. They can copy the color. They can copy the images on it. They can do everything. But the problem is that the money, how do we know it's real money? Well, if you've ever looked at it and you hold it up to the light, you can see a little security tape that's in there. Sometimes made of plastic, sometimes metal, depending on the size of the bill. But when you look up there, you can see, and that's how they weave it into that. They put it inside that money so we know that it's real. And see, they can't just copy that. They have to have special machines to do all that stuff. Well, why are we talking about money right now? Well, see, sometimes in life, as Christians, we may be doing the same thing. We're coming to church, and we sit here in the pew, and we give our money to the tithe, and we sing, but we're just doing it outwardly, all right? We want to make sure that we're being the person that God wants us to be inside. So if you have your Bible, we're going to turn to 1 Samuel chapter 16, all right? Uh-oh, we're going Old Testament. Yeah, it's still there. We still use it, all right? So right after, go right to Ruth, next one. Be 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 7. Now, this is when Samuel is looking for the king. God sent him to get the king, and he's going to look, and he's going to find out. He sees some big guys. He's like, this has got to be the one. This is it. Hear what the Lord has to say. 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 7. But the Lord said to Samuel, do not look at his appearance or at his physical stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord does not see as man sees. For man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. Guys, that's what we're talking about here. All right, kids, we got to make sure. You're coming to church, and everybody knows you as going to First Baptist Church and First Boonville Church, and you're excited to be here, and we love you being here. But are you being that person, that Christian? See, God sees that. Are you being the Christian on the inside? We don't want to be counterfeit Christians, do we? We don't want to be fake Christians. We want to have that heart that the Lord's looking for. So when you leave here today, when you go out and you have a chance to get, you're getting back with your friends maybe and getting a visit, make sure that they know who you really are, that they see that heart that God wants you to have. All right? So if you would, pray with me real quick. If you don't know the Lord today, maybe today be the day. Let him know that you want to make that decision. I want every one of y'all to be a Christian and be walking with us today. I'm glad to be here with y'all, and I'm excited. Pray with me if you would. Lord, thank you so much for bringing all these kids here today and bringing all the adults. We're so excited to be back in your house of worship. Lord, we know that the building, it's not the building that makes the church, it's the people. Lord, it's you in our hearts, and we thank you so much for giving us an opportunity to see that again, to see that we need to make adjustments. I'm so excited to be back here. Lord, if there's any today that don't know you, may today be the day that they make that decision, that we do not want to be fake. We do not want to be counterfeit. We don't want people to see us and then later on realize that everything about us was not true, was not truly you. Lord, help us have the heart that you'd want us to have. Let us have the heart of David and have a heart for you. In your name we pray, amen. Thank you.
Well, good morning. Thank you, Donnie. It's interesting how over the last few weeks, Lord's kind of put us in a place where we are doing things the way we did years ago, you know. I've heard, you know, Grandpa always told me life was cyclic, and it's certainly come to fruition. I've got the bulletin from the last time we had worship in here. I was just thinking how quickly, you know, things changed. And it's good to see you this morning, and I can't tell you how much I look forward to today. Bittersweet in a way that so good to be back, but yet still so many, that I miss. And I hope you've noticed how hard it is to maintain relationships within his kingdom without this service, that it really does play much more of a role maybe than what we ever considered. But it's good to see you, good to shake hand, good to face bump, good to elbow bump. Whatever you're willing to give me this morning, I'll take it. It's just a joy to see. As far as announcements go, we're going to have some meetings coming up over the next few weeks about cleaning up and get some things done around here. But other than that, folks, I just want to thank you for your faithfulness during this time. We've not really seen any, not been any kind of bind whatsoever. Now, we've not really gone out and done a whole lot of stuff because, man, what do you do, right? I know we're going through this personally, just in our lives, but maybe it's almost over. But then again, this week, and we'll be talking about it this morning in the message, what in the world is going on? You know, I always heard the statement, we live in uncertain times. That is not true at all. There has never been a more certain time than there is right now. There has been, never been a time where his prophecy is more certainly fulfilled than it is right now. So this morning, I was going to start a series on just life's little pieces, but I'm going to back up just a little bit to address some things, and mainly dealing with fear and faith, but just some contemporary issues. Where does the Christian stand with all this? You know, the involvement, lack of involvement, what should the voice of the church say? Just things I think we have to identify. I'm not telling you what to do, but kind of where's God's stance in all this? Something that I've certainly been trying to figure out and just been silent a lot lately as I seek the Lord's wisdom. And the voice of the church has been silent for generations. You know, the voice, us kind of making a strong stand. And I'm just asking the Lord to make it so obvious when it's time for us to stand that we can't ignore it. And I'd ask for you to join me in that prayer, that there are things that we cannot sacrifice without a little turmoil. And I don't believe we're there yet. But never before in our lifetime, I would argue, does our country need our prayer, the prayer of the church, but also the encouraging, inspirational hope of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So if we believe he is the healer, if we believe he is the peacemaker, the peacekeeper, it is his audience we should seek. So let's pray, and we're going to begin our service. Lord, I love you, and I thank you for the beauty of this morning. And the absolute privilege it is, the honor of my life, to see my brothers and sisters, my friends, and my family. Lord, over the last 10 weeks, we have gone through a gamut of emotions, processing situations, responding, Lord, just however we had to get through each day. But I pray this morning you'd give your people peace, you'd give us clarity, you'd give us direction. Lord, there is nothing that has ever taken you by surprise, and it is time that the church stop being surprised, disappointed, or disillusioned by the events of a fallen world. You've warned us, you've told us. It is time for us to hold our head up and continue the mission that you've given us. Lord, you have strategically placed this church and this community to have an impact in a region. And I pray, Lord, that our heart, our efforts, our resources would go and seeing salvations, life changes, marriages healed, addictions broken. Because, Lord, you are the overcomer. You are the one that overcame. You are the one that will overcome. And it is in the name of the conqueror, Jesus Christ, the rider who will ride in to receive his bride, the King of glory. Amen.
What can wash away our sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make us whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Your blood speaks a better word than all the empty claims I've heard upon this earth. It speaks righteousness for me, stands in my defense. Jesus, it's your blood. Your blood speaks a better word than all
much for allowing us to be back in your presence. God, I just pray that we would never forget how much you love us. Never. Father, that as Pastor Eric comes, Lord, that what you've laid on his heart this week, Father, that it would be just what we needed to hear for such a time as this, God. I thank you again for the all that you've done for us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
If you have your Bible with you, and I hope you do, otherwise you can Google the verse real fast, whatever it is you need to do. But we'll be in Ecclesiastes chapter 1 and verse 9 beginning. We'll look at a few different passages this morning. They'll be on the screen here, but if you'll begin there with me. Thank you, Ricky. Good job. Thank you, praise team. Spent some time this morning praying for Kyle and Chris, the pastor there at First Van Buren. We expect great things from them, and kind of put kind of what will be happening in the search and the beacon. But if you have any questions for me, let me know. But we will be putting together some form of survey for you to fill out to kind of let you know what are some of the major elements you'd like to see. I'm not a singer. I'm not a music guy, really. So I really don't. I just want to, music is a personal thing. Some people like this, some people like that. So, again, we're going to find a kind of a consensus as a church and let the church speak, okay? And whatever that is, folks, just know that you've had a voice, and so does the church. So no single voice is above the value as the church corporately. So, again, unity being the most important thing we can have during this time, but we are in very, very good hands, folks. I'm in no hurry, not feeling any stress whatsoever, and I like that. Well, it's good to have you back, and man, it's just good to see people out there. I can't tell you how boring it is to preach to empty pews. I don't want anybody to think we're being insensitive or ignoring a potential risk, but again, you encourage people to do whatever they feel led to do. It's not my place to make up someone else's mind. That's the joy of this country, but again, I'm not going to police anybody, and I don't really desire anybody to police me. Everybody kind of get that, so let's just go on and let everybody make up their own decisions out of respect. But again, what's been on my heart, I was working on this, and then just honestly this morning driving in, I was reading the news this morning when I got up, laying in bed, and man, it just burdened me a little bit. Set me back a little with all the chaos, and we just got through a series on finding calm in the chaos, but where am I supposed to be? Because there's so many things I've heard said over my lifetime that kind of, in a way, brings in this idea of doom and gloom, and what is it that Scripture tells me? How am I to approach each day? How am I supposed to get up and look at all this carelessness, this hate, this vindictive approach, this pain, the murder, abuse, burn, all this different stuff, and think, all right, Lord, this is the day that you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And, we have to remember, I think, in these times that Satan comes to steal, to kill, and destroy. So any kind of diversion, any kind of distraction, and he's the master of chaos, the master of confusion. Anything he can do to offset, listen, your hope has undermined the fulfillment of the Great Commission of Jesus Christ. And so as a believer, there's things that I've got to go back and just remember. I've got to remind myself every day. And faith, friend, is not something that just exists on its own. It has to be fed. It has to be nurtured. It has to be affirmed. It has to be secured, and it is by his blood. But friend, there's a part. There's a responsibility on you. But first, I would say, in evaluating this thing, we are living, like I said earlier, in absolutely certain times. Scripture told us things were happening. Guess what? My preacher growing up told me these things would happen. Did your preacher growing up tell you they would happen? Well, sure they did. So, folks, it's kind of time we find a little bit of security in those things we say we know instead of living in the chaos the rest of the world can choose to live in. I do not want my marriage living in the same chaos the marriages of the world live in. Do you? Do I want my children acting like the hellions of the world? No, there's things that, and there's priorities, there's convictions, there's morals, there's rules, there's laws, there's promises, all these things that set my life in a different course. So why is it when the world has looked at the church over the last few weeks, first, we've been absent for the most part. Second, we've been as worried and insecure as a lost worldling bound to an eternity in hell rather than the hopeful, trustful, and inspirational people that follow the Almighty and trust His promises and have the security of heaven. Now, how come we're so worried about dying when dying's the greatest reward we could be given? There's just, and I'm not, I'm not saying don't practice caution. What I'm saying, friend, is there is nothing about this time that should make me worry or set me off course. When He created me, when He created you, He created us, as Ricky just said, for such a time as this, so that I and my faith can show those folks first the boldness of the cross and the promises of Jesus Christ. If they don't see it in me, how are you going to see it in me? So that's what this series is all about, is taking all the pieces and putting them together on the foundation of hope rather than the insecurity of a fallen world. This world's fallen, friend. Literally going to hell in a handbasket. And Jesus Christ intervened to redeem. I accepted that redemption, as did you, I hope. And that changed things. If it didn't change things, what good is it? Let's look at these three passages first, the times. I've heard people say, oh, it's just getting bad. It's worse than it's ever been. Folks, what has been will be again. What has been done will be done again. There is nothing new under the sun. I first heard this in a conversation with my father-in-law. Before we were married, we were sitting in the living room one time. I'd never heard this passage. And I don't remember. I was planning on being a pastor. He was pastoring a mission church. And he said this statement. Man, it hit me hard. All the times I get worked up about something new, something that I've never seen, or something that, man, this is crazy stuff. This is far out there. This is the end of the world as we know it. No, do you realize Sodom and Gomorrah, how absolutely deprived it was? Okay, me and Ricky were talking about this week. The people were, kids are in here, trying to have relationships with the angels, the messengers sent. Do you realize that? Men, yes, having a sexual desire for a man, which is not scriptural. Do you hear me, boys? Anna, you hear me? Okay. So, friend, what has been in the past, I don't get to hammer them on like that when they're over in children's church, Donnie babysitting them and giving them dollars. Did you tithe off that dollar, Donnie? He didn't answer. Let's Sandy check that. So anyway, when I woke up this morning and I'm looking all that and I'm reading all this mess, and folks, I get worked up. I mean, I'm not a consistent individual. I don't know if you've noticed that. I get wound plumb tight. Yeah. And so I see this going on, and everything in me wants to do something, right? Haven't you kind of felt that over the last few weeks? You're just tired of it. You're tired of, you don't know what the truth is. You're tired of thinking, well, at some time, we got to fight. You know, I mean, there's all this emotion going on, and it's pinned up. It's frustration, and you're just ready to go out and scream. And if one more person tells me what way I have to go down an aisle, I'm likely to backhand somebody. There's just a lot of this going on, right? It just is. And so I've got to step back and say, Lord, man, I don't know how to handle this. But you do, because there's nothing that's done today that's not been done before. Now, they probably didn't have stickers back in the New Testament on the aisles, okay? But the fact is, there's been pestilence, there's been disease before. Friend, it's happened in our lifetime again. Satan has a way, even when you look at the cycle of things, it happens so routinely, it's almost predictable, and yet it catches us completely by surprise. God works in such a way that you will see a consistent hand in history, and you'll see a consistent hand in your life. You know, when given a graph, if you will, of a Christian life, most of our lives, right, are up and down, but even that is a significant amount of consistency, is it not? There's those high where we're walking with the Lord, we feel like everything's just right. And then there's those lows where we know we got to get things back in order, things aren't right, just marriage, finance, whatever. But life is just a matter of patterns. And I'm not trying to make this a small thing, but friend, I mean, scientifically, it was predictable, you know? So what do I do with all of this frustration? What do I do with the confusion? What do I do in this quest to try to figure out the truth? I give that up because I surrendered that at the cross of Jesus Christ. Here's a fact. I'm not stupid, but I ain't smart enough to figure it out. Friend, the place my mind goes to figure things out, I know, is half the time and even logical, right? Because fear is my motivator when I try to figure, when I try to control, rather than saying, Lord, we got a mess here. And we have allowed Satan to divide, to destroy, to stick his nasty, putrid hand into the beauty, into the fabric of our families, of our country, of our churches. And we have not fought. Listen, the battle is not against flesh and blood. Listen to me. It's not against a white man. It's not against a black man. It's not against an Asian man. It's not against a Hispanic. It's not against an Indian man or Native American. The battle is spiritual, and the battle belongs to the Lord. So my job this morning was to get up and recognize the field exists. It's there. Friend, we're all frustrated, confused, doubtful. Trust is really being swayed right now as to where, who we are as a country, who we are as a people, who we are as a community, who we are as a church. So I've got to step back and remember, there's nothing new about this. All right, so what was new to me would not have been new to those who've gone before us. So God has already been through this. What has been will be again. Here's the other thing with sin, friend. There's no new sin under the sun. God set this thing in course, and it's going to make it until he returns. Do you understand? Now, here's it. The sun is not going to burn out before the rapture happens. Do you get that? Or Scripture's a lie. Do you get that? So don't go out in the yard and stare up the sun, wait for that baby to burn out, and you freeze to death. Fact is, the only thing you've got to worry about is your relationship with Jesus Christ and your direct involvement in the fulfillment of the Great Commission. The sun ain't going to burn out. The stars ain't going to fall. There's not going to be an earthquake to kill us all. Jesus is coming to get his people when it's time to get you out. Does that register? So quit getting so wound up in the goings-ons when you ain't going to be here for them. Does that make sense? Unless you're post-trib. You're on your own. If you don't get that, research it a little bit. I ain't got time this morning. Most of us are pre-trib, which means we believe the rapture is going to happen before the seven-year tribulation, okay? Now, here's the other thing. Everybody's flipping out about a microchip. Let me tell you something. I don't want one either. That's a big needle. All right, that's mainly my objection to that thing. It's a big needle. But friend, mark of the beast, no. The way I understand Scripture is we're out of here for that. Now, I don't want it. I'm going to hide when they come and try to give it to me. Again, because it's a big needle. Not because I think I'm going to hell if I get it. All right? Because here, let me tell you something else. If you're a Christian, can you lose your salvation? Okay. Let's use our common sense words now. Right, or common sense thinking. If I'm a Christian and the mark of the beast comes out, I can't lose my Jesus, right? So what in the world are you afraid of? All right, so we don't want the chip. Everybody understand that? Say amen. All right, but that ain't got nothing to do with you going to hell. You understand that? All right, don't worry about that. Just run from that big needle. What has been will be again. What has been done will be done again. Friend, hey, you can't stop depravity. You can't. And that's why the Lord said, hey, you want these things? I'm going to turn you over to them. So it is true that a nation can begin more morally sound than what it will be after centuries, because God will say, if you want that nastiness, because if you'll look over the cycle of humanity throughout history, civilizations have rose and then what? God's hand has been evident, and then God's hand... Here's the other thing. There's no guarantee that the United States will be as it is and as we know it before he comes. Do you understand that? While my citizenship as a temporal human being is here, my eternal citizenship is where? With Jesus Christ. So my first loyalty is to the banner of the cross and the person of Jesus Christ. So my security is always there. But do I have a responsibility as a citizen in a country that has a direct impact on the way we worship, live, and the life my family will have to be involved in it? Yeah. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Has been done, will be done again. There's nothing new under the sun. Let's keep going. Dottie took out a little more time than I hoped, so we're going to have to move faster. I'm kidding. Did a good job, man. I really enjoyed it. That was fun. Guys, I really like my kids in here. And I'll just say, before we get back to all that, I didn't grow up in kids' church. Matter of fact, I was hired to give you kids' church 13 years ago. And I've struggled with it a lot. And I know as people visit, they really like their kids to go over there, and that's all fine and well. But I do want to encourage you, when this is over, feel free to keep your kids in here, okay? That does not distract me. What's most distracting is when you people fall asleep. All right. So we got the times and now the people. 2 Timothy 3:13 through 15. Evil people and imposters will become worse, deceiving and being deceived. But as for you, continue in what you've learned and firmly believed. You know those who taught you, and you know that from infancy you have known the sacred scriptures, who's able to give you wisdom for salvation through Christ Jesus. So friend, I didn't set that thing up. We'll have to wait till next week. Here's the fact: we know evil folks will proceed from bad to worse, from deceiving to being deceived. So is it surprising that the deprived seem to continually become more and more immoral? No, Scripture tells us that. So do not be surprised when people start hurting other people, when people start hurting children. Is it okay? No. But friend, he said, guys, this is all going to happen. And it's all happened in other places before. Well, you say, well, pornography. Well, I would argue that pornography is more accessible than it has ever been in human history. You have a TV in your hand with unlimited access. So mom and dad, little Johnny and little Sally do not need to be sent off to tap into the depths of depravity. Everybody understand that? Please say amen. I'm not telling you how to parent, but I guess I'm telling you how not to, okay? You cannot trust that situation. So again, this is all, guys, we knew this was going to happen, but as for me, so when this is happening, what am I supposed to do? Am I supposed to sit over with my head down and my tail tucked? Am I supposed to go away and hide in some shelter, right? Because things are just getting bad out there. It says, no, continue in what you've learned. Don't do anything different than what I told you to do. He said, I gave you the solution. The solution is the gospel of Jesus Christ, which changed men's hearts, right? So how will they hear without a preacher? Friend, I've told you, never before have we had a grander opportunity. When I say we, that pronoun is for you and I, not for humanity. Do you realize there has been revivals before our time? Do you realize there's been very few in our time? If everything is cyclic, it's time. Everything is there but the church, okay? And I don't mean this morning, friend. That's not what I'm talking about. We are so much bigger than this little building right here. Continue in what you've learned and firmly believed. And maybe this is the issue. Maybe we've learned something, but maybe we've not firmly believed it. Because, I mean, bad news really rocks our world as Christians. Do you realize how many of us have to be comforted through hard times? Where is Jesus the comforter, right? He's the one that's supposed to give me strength, peace, clarity, inspiration, healing. But yet we seek the wisdom of the world. You know those who taught you. You know those who gave you guidance. Go to those who will give you biblical sound guidance no matter the hardship. And you know that from infancy, you have known the sacred scripture. Sacred. Notice the description of the scripture. Sacred meaning inerrant, infallible, applicable, true, valuable, worth your time. Worth your attention. Let's go to number three. The time, the people, the message. For the time will come, and again, you know these verses, friend, but when you look at the news, when you look at the headlines, when you're scrolling through your Facebook, when you're getting your notifications that there's another protest, mail-in ballots, another stimulus package, the sky is literally falling. I mean, I don't remember a time in my life where there was more trash and confusion and frustration being thrown in my face. I don't remember a time I ever felt more insecure as a citizen of the United States of America. I do not remember a time in all of my life where I was more fearful for those three than I am right now. While I knew, and here's the reality, we knew it was coming. It's here. You see the difference? I remember a time where everything was just like I remembered it from infancy. Do you realize how much has changed in the course of my generation's life? We've gone from I don't even know how to describe this anymore. We don't feel anything. Do you know who the moral conscience is? The Holy Spirit. Do you know where he goes, where he's invited? It is as if you picture heaven, earth, right? And I don't know that heaven's up here, maybe over here, but that's just the way we're kind of always imagine things. And then the church is the door, right, whereby people generally come to Jesus Christ. And so the church, listen, it's consistently getting smaller exponentially. And the world is becoming less or more and more ignorant of the sacred scripture exponentially. So where's the problem? It's me. It's you. Do you realize what stupid stuff I have let distract me from what I'm supposed to do? Guys, this is baloney. Do you realize it? Next week, it's old news, right? But what did it do to you today? Think about it. Huh? What did it do? Distracted you, destroyed your hope, it frustrated you, it caused you to question so many things. When he said, guys, I've told you the time will come when people will be so stupid they'd rather make up a lie and believe something they know is not true than to want the truth. Now, did you catch the depravity there? I'm going to make something up I know is not true and choose to believe it. Oh, that's a special kind of stupid. And we got it all over us. My friend, now listen. Don't you believe stupid stuff. Believe true stuff. And so, before we go pointing fingers, friend, and because here, this is me. I've worried. I believe some stupid stuff. I was worried. I was scared to death. I was the first one. Because when the week after that, the Monday after that bulletin, it started coming unraveled. What would church look like in 6 months? How would I support my family? I'm just being transparent with you. who do I beat up over this, right? I believe something that was not right here. I got angry, I got frustrated, and I doubted. These verses are just telling me, son, since you was a baby, you remember when your grandma took you to church, Eric, do you remember what you were told? You were told to trust me. You were told not to fear. You were told to cast all your cares, all your anxieties on the Lord, and he will care for you. Eric, I told you if you'd acknowledge me in all your ways, I'd direct your paths. And you're not acknowledging me. You're acknowledging all of the information that is bombarding you that is a tool of Satan because it's not true. Now, is there a virus? Sure. I have no reason to doubt that. Are there some things out there that are not true? Obviously. But here's what I know. I'm not here. I can't solve all your questions and problems. This is true. It's what I leave here today with. It's what I had to get in my truck this morning and drive around for a little while and refocus. Because, man, folks, what I'm seeing, I hate. I hate it. I hate seeing God's people turn on each other. A country that was sacrificed for throughout generations, literally being torn apart at the seams. There's nothing new under the sun. Evil men and imposters will always perceive from bad, deceiving to being deceived, bad to worse. But good people have to become God's people, not just good people anymore. And the time will come when people would rather lie than tell the truth. They'll turn away from hearing, but as for me, it says exercise self-control. What's that mean? That means I take these thoughts and I bring them into captivity and say no more. No more with you. No more lies. No more fear. In everything, endure hardship, do the work of a bearer of the good news. Juan Galitzo. Wow. That's a. I wish Jeanette would do stuff like that. Fulfill your ministry. Look at this personal pronoun. Your ministry. I and you have an opportunity to have an impact because we are created, just how it started, for such a time as this. You and you and you all have a part to play in this thing. But it is not running around like a blooming idiot. It is standing like you know something, that you know Jesus Christ. Lord, we love you. We thank you for the joy, for the confidence that we have in the cross. And Lord, we come.